Welcome to worship this day, the fifth Sunday after Pentecost. We also welcome our Facebook Live worshipers this morning. And I say a special hello because I'm hoping my mom is watching. Hi, Mom. She's not ever missed my last Sunday in any church, so I didn't want her to miss today just because she couldn't be here. Anyway, I got a box of Kleenex. I'm good. I thank the congregation for these beautiful flowers and that piece by the bell choir. That was wonderful. I did want to let you know that this morning we're taking just another step toward normal, and we're going to pass the offering plates this morning, and Emily will be blessing us with your beautiful voice for our offertory this morning. Let us continue.
Good morning. A few instructions about what's going to be going on today. At the last hymn, Be Thou My Vision, during the singing of the last verse, Sarah will lead us out to the labyrinth. And you're welcome to follow us out there. We'll all go and circle around the labyrinth. We're going to have a special butterfly release. We'll have some in a box to be released, and some will be given to some people in little envelopes. And we've checked them, and so we hope they are all going to fly when we want them to fly. And so if you'll join us out there for our benediction, and then following the butterfly release, we will go back to the fellowship hall, and if you will pick up your box lunch and take it to a table, and then we have a special presentation for Sarah, and after the presentation and the meal over the food, then we'll begin eating. So I just wanted to let y'all know the plan, and everybody is welcome to stay. We will have plenty of food for everybody. So please stay for us as we have a wonderful celebration today. Let us begin with our invocation. When we care for the poor, clothe the naked, and visit the sick and imprisoned, we are caring for Christ. When we love our neighbor, we are really loving God. Let us pray. Glorious God, shine upon us with your spirit of wisdom and truth. Enlighten our hearts. Help us to know the hope to which we are called. Reveal your ways that we might share hope and joy in all that we do and all that we say. In the light of Christ's love, we pray. Amen. Please stand for our first hymn.
Thank you.
remain standing for our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed, found on page 881 of your hymnal, and it's also printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. You may be seated. The epistle lesson is from Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. This can be found in your pew Bible on page 983. What then shall we say to this? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not also give us all things with him? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Is it Christ Jesus who died? Yes, who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Will the children please come down? Why don't you sit right there, Grayson? That'll be great. Aw. Okay, y'all. That's cool. What is that? Interesting. So today's my last Sunday with y'all. And I just want to thank you so much, because it's been a pleasure knowing you. And have you ever heard of a shalom blessing? It's a way of wishing persons we're going to say goodbye to the many blessings of shalom, which include peace, health, prosperity, happiness, well-being, and all the good things you can think of. That is what I wish for each one of you. You have been a very special part of my time as I've been in Wadesboro. Now, before I came to Wadesboro, some of you knew this, some of you weren't even born. I was in a nursing home getting better from a real bad car wreck. And when I was there, I got these two pictures that meant so much to me, and I put them up on my wall. Madeline, you did this one 6 years ago. How old were you then? You were little. And this is Tori did this one, Victoria, and Miss Barbara sent them to me. And I've kept them all this time, and they went up on my wall, and it just made me know that I was gonna really have some sweet people here, and it meant a lot. You didn't know me yet, or you'd have drawn one too, I think, Livy, probably. But it was just you two in the Sunday school class, right? Yeah, yeah. And that meant a lot to me. They reminded me that I already had new friends here in Wadesboro that I hadn't even met. So today is my last Sunday as your minister, and I have to say goodbye. And you know, people can't be replaced. But when you say goodbye to somebody, sometimes there's something new coming next. I know. Is it that way? Yeah. Anyway, I have somebody new that's going to come see you soon. A new minister and her husband will be coming real soon. And her name is Stacy, and you probably call her Pastor Stacy. She'll let you know what to call her, and her husband, Kevin. And they're coming. She will be your new minister. So I don't want you to think about losing me so much, but gaining a new friend. Because after Wednesday, I won't be your pastor anymore, but I will always be your friend, and I will always love and care for you. Okay? We don't always understand why we have to say goodbye to the people we love, why they might move away, but you know what? We need to trust that God has something amazing in store for us and for them. Sometimes that amazing thing can only happen if we say goodbye first. Let's pray. Dear God, I thank you for your love and mercy. Help us to always trust in you in every area of our lives. Bless all our friends with your shalom. Amen. Now, I think we want everyone to stay here, but your people, Miss Gail's got something special planned. So why don't the persons that know what's going on and have something to do with it, and the rest of us, let's just watch and listen. You can move up there, yeah. Thank you. Thank you. And I have something else. Some of you may, your parents may have these, but as I was packing up, I realized I still had some of the bookmarks that my mother cross-stitched a while back. And so I think I have enough for each one of you. I don't know, you may have one already from your Bible, but let's see how many I got. You can have one, and you can have it and save it and put it when you get older. I didn't get to give you one with your Bible. Here. Wait a minute. Yeah. Wait a minute. You've already got, I got just enough, I think. Can they share one? Here you go. Is that okay? Okay, thank you all so much. And you can remember me all. Thank you so much, Grayson. Thank you. Thank you, Libby. I'm so glad you're here today. I have some praise, some concerns that I want to share with you, prayer concerns, before we go to God in prayer. I do have a praise because I have a bunch of friends that came today, and some of them surprised me and came from a long way. But it's so nice to have these people because they've known me a long time. Every one of them have known me a really long time. So, and still they want to come and be with me, y'all. So, what does that say? What does that say? Or else Kathy paid them. I'm not sure which way it was. I'd like you to continue to pray for Bruce Handy. He's the minister that's been at Marshville, and he'll be moving to Covenant in Charlotte. I mentioned the past two Sundays that his wife was in very serious condition and had a cardiac arrest. Well, they took her off life support on Tuesday, and she passed away about noon that day. And they had a service of resurrection for her yesterday at Marshville. And he's still moving and everything, so just keep them in your prayers, because I know that would mean a lot to them. And Kyle Beam had an injury last week at work and is going to have some surgery this week, so keep him in your prayer. And I have been asking prayers for my mother, and she is doing a lot better, a lot better. So thank you for that. Continued prayers for Lula Ann Davis, Pamela Turner, Eleanor Pesci, Lonnie Baucom, Elwood Green, Nancy Huntley, Lib Huntley, Dot Huntley, Gail Leideker's mom, Martha Stacker, and Julie Tyson Williams. We pray for all that are fighting cancer and for their families and caregivers, and also those that have been affected by COVID. Continued prayers for those on our prayer list and anonymous prayers. There's a few out there. And just know that there are people that covet your prayers. They're just not ready to share who they are. So let us go to God in prayer at this time. God of glory, we do not always see your glory in the world around us. When we see a person in need, it's not easy to look them in the eye. When we hear a cry for help, it is not easy to offer quick assurance. When we know of a lonely prisoner, it's not easy to make that unannounced visit. Forgive us, Lord, when we fail to see you in our everyday lives. Forgive us when we are afraid to act, afraid to care. Encourage us, God of glory. Help us to see others with the eyes of compassion, that we might be your loving presence in this world. In the name of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, We pray all this, the names we have mentioned out loud and the names on our hearts, praying the prayer that he taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would the ushers come forward to receive the morning offering? There we go. They're having to learn new tricks, y'all, remembering the old ways. They're right there, where they always were. Let us pray. We offer these gifts to you, O Lord, as food and drink for a hungry world, as clothing and shelter for those who are naked and homeless, as kindness and compassion for those who are most in need of mercy. Transform these gifts that they might be your hands and feet in the world. Send us forth as your people, that all we do and all that we say may be a glorious representation of your presence in the world. With gratitude we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
please remain standing for the gospel lesson? I'll be reading from the gospel according to Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 through 40. And if you want to follow along in your pew Bible, it's page 861. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will place the sheep at his right hand, but the goats at the left. And then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see thee hungry and feed thee, or thirsty and give thee drink? And when did we see thee a stranger and welcome thee, or naked and clothe thee? And when did we see thee sick or in prison and visit thee?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, you did it to me." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. In preparation for this Sunday's worship service, Emily asked me what my favorite hymns were. Well, I knew right off the bat the hymn that I would always ask for the congregation to sing on my last Sunday, and that was Be Thou My Vision, which is my favorite hymn. Yeah, usually I only ask for that one, but this time it really is my last Sunday. Oh, I'll probably preach somewhere else, but my last Sunday is being a full-time pastor, before retirement anyway. So I thought back. Of course, we'd sing Be Thou My Vision, and Spirit Song, which we just sang, means a lot to me. But I couldn't think of a third hymn that I wanted us to sing. And then it came to me. I'm telling you a little bit of my story. So I thought, I love to tell the story would be the perfect hymn. You see, my life's work has been to tell the story of God's love. And then back when I was younger, in the 60s, every time I'd visit my granddaddy in Asheville, he would have us sing this hymn on the Wednesday night that he led the prayer meeting. I think my call to ministry began and was fed by my grandfather. Well, back when I was in the nursing home for rehab the summer of 2015, and in a way that seems like yesterday, and in a way it seems like a long time ago. But I was wondering, when am I going to be able to move to Wadesboro? I was reading my upper room, and there it was, a story of a woman packing up all her mother's stuff to sell her house, and she describes all the stuff her mom has. Wow, that was speaking to me. I feel like all I have done for the past 3 months is toss, donate, and shred all the stuff that I have collected over the years. I found that I had stuff from way too far back that I had no reason for keeping, except I just didn't do anything with it. I got rid of things I thought I would never rid myself of. But if you walked into the condo that I've moved into right now, you would say, "What did you get rid of? You still have a lot of stuff." Nancy, quit shaking your head because she's seen it. She's seen it. I'm going to work on that stuff too. But what I learned from all this process is we don't need all these things. The best things in life come from God. So I want to pass on to you as I move and your new pastor arrives to join you soon. The best things in life come from God. We are to listen to God and follow the directions that God is leading us in. And over these past years, I feel like this church, First Wadesboro, has been learning that, especially when COVID hit. How are we going to keep doing what we can keep doing? But we worked on it, and I know you'll continue to work on it. And this church is never going to be like it was years ago, though this is some of the most amount of people I've seen in the congregation in a long time. But no church will look like the churches looked years ago. But that doesn't mean that we're not a vital part of the community. And God will continue to lead us as we minister and reach out to our community. Last Sunday, as we honored Cameron and baptized Brooks, he's telling y'all about it, you know, right now. It reminded us of what it means to be the church. We are a family. And we hold up our family, and we stand behind our family, and we help our family. And to be able to do that, we commit to the church to support it with our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. Those are the very things that will keep this church and all churches going. Our commitment to follow God, to make sure people learn about God, and not say, well, somebody else can do it. We all have a part in doing that. A church goer wrote a letter to the editor of a newspaper and complained that it made no sense at all to attend church every Sunday. He said, I've gone for 30 years now, and that time I've heard something like 3,000 sermons. But for the life of me, I can't remember a single one of them. So I think I'm wasting my time, and the pastors are wasting their time by giving sermons at all. Well, this started a real controversy in the letters to the editor column, which, of course, the editor loved that, and it went on for weeks. Until somebody wrote this letter. I've been married for 37 years now. In that time, my wife has cooked some 32,000 meals. But for the life of me, I cannot recall the entire menu for a single one of those meals. But I do know this. They all nourished me and gave me strength I needed to do my work. If my wife had not given me those meals, I would be physically dead today. Likewise, if I had not gone to church for nourishment, I would be spiritually dead today. When you are down to nothing, God is up to something. Faith sees the invisible, believes the incredible, and receives the impossible. We thank God for our physical and our spiritual nourishment. And during these 6 years, you have provided me with plenty of physical nourishment. Meals, goodies that people have brought in, loaves of bread. Oh my goodness. But what I pray is that some sermon or some newsletter article or Bible study or Sunday school lesson or prayer or devotion or conversation has provided an element of spiritual nourishment for you. But just in case it hasn't, I thought I would share my favorite scripture passages with you. Now, Krista read from the 8th chapter of Romans, and the whole chapter 8 is special. But verse 31, Romans 8:31, caught my eye during a Bible study in high school. It just made sense. God was with you when no one was. If God was on your side, no one could be against you. It meant the same to me as it did to the Roman people that Paul was writing to. As a teenager, it meant that when my friends left me, I still had God. I wasn't alone. It meant when I didn't have all the answers in class, I wasn't a total dummy. I had God. And it meant that I didn't have to go along with the crowd and do the things I knew were wrong. I had God. I wasn't alone. And when I was in a head-on car wreck that put me out for more than 3 months, it was really 5 months, I don't know why I wrote three, maybe I was hoping, when I'm supposed to be moving, that God will provide for me. I can move to a new place and not feel scared and lonely because I have God. I can step out and try new things because I am not alone. I have God. I can share my thoughts and beliefs that others will listen because I am not alone. I have God. If God is for me, who can be against me? And my other favorite scripture passage is what I read to you from the Gospel of Matthew in the 25th chapter. God called me to ministry through this passage of scripture, and I'm not going to go through that because I think I've shared that with you. When we serve others, we are serving Christ. When I look in the face of my brother or sister, I am looking in the face of Christ. And when you look at me, you're looking at the face of Christ. It's that simple. Both of these passages have made a huge impact on my life since I was a teenager, and I pass that on to you as I leave Wadesboro. It's all in our attitude. Nowhere in the Bible does it say we are supposed to have a bad attitude. The Bible is full of stories of how we can look at the glass half full and see the silver lining and forgive and love. The 92-year-old petite, well-poised, and proud lady who is fully dressed each morning by 8 o'clock a.m. with her hair fashionably fixed and makeup perfectly applied, even though she is legally blind, was moving into a nursing home that day. Her husband of 70 years recently passed away, making the move necessary. After many hours of waiting patiently in the lobby of the nursing home, she smiled sweetly when she was told her room was ready. As she maneuvered her walker to the elevator, the attendant provided a visual description of her tiny room, including the eyelet sheets that had been hung on her window. "I love it," she stated with the enthusiasm of an 8-year-old having been just presented with a new puppy. "But Mrs. Jones, you haven't seen the room. Just wait. "That doesn't have anything to do with it," she replied. "Happiness is something you decide on ahead of time. Whether I like my room or not doesn't depend on how the furniture is arranged. It's how I arrange my mind. I've already decided to love it. It's a decision I make every morning when I wake up. I have a choice. I can spend the day in bed recounting the difficulty I have with the parts of my body that no longer work, or get out of bed and be thankful for the ones that do. Each day is a gift, and as long as my eyes open, I'll focus on the new day and all the happy memories I've stored away just for this time in my life. Old age is like a bank account. You withdraw from what you've put in. So my advice to you would be to deposit a lot of happiness in the bank account of memories. What wise words from someone struggling with so much. I just want you to remember, this isn't goodbye. It's so long for now. You have a new minister moving in this coming week, and I'm beginning a new chapter in my life. I have no idea where it will take me, but I'm very excited to find out. After I leave, and this is very important, after I leave, I cease being your minister, but I will always be your friend. I thank you for filling my memory bank these past 6 years. You made a huge deposit. God bless all of you. I love you. Amen. Let us stand.